for me, the making of The Winds of War was one of the great experiences of my life. It was everything that I could ever imagine, all rolled into one. It was like making, it was 18 hours. It's like making 9 movies. But 9 movies of the kind of material that I love, recreating history where it actually happened. It was the most exciting experience.
Action!
Your party's passports, may I have them, please?
I am reluctant to surrender them for obvious reasons.
I assure you it's quite routine.
There isn't anyone insane enough to think that they could do this project on their own, both as producer and director. Totally suits Dan with all his staggering energy and his operatic sense of life. And I think it was just absolutely wonderful and brilliant that Dan and this project merged.
I don't think many people besides Dan Curtis could have choreographed what the making of Winds of War was about. Who could possibly say, for budgetary reasons, we're going to have to stay in this country, and the former Yugoslavia was one of the main ones. We're going to stay in this country, and we're going to make a facsimile of 9 different countries in Europe over a period of 5 years. And sometimes we're going to have to split the scene up into it's they entered the building, they walked up the stairs, they went into the room, and then on the reverse shot, we'd like that on the wall. And those 4 bits would take place months apart, all out of order, without missing a beat. And then you'd be over with it, change your clothes, grab a coffee, and be into a whole other part of the world. And yet you'd still go home to the same hotel. It was a sort of odd adrenaline rush, to be honest with you. It was very crazy, and I don't recall that anything ever really got screwed up. That's quite remarkable.
Get rid of that. Let's go with your people.
Yeah, that throws me, to tell you the truth.
Well, let's go on now. How about this? We don't even know if they're going. If they go, he can come and fetch me. Change that. But we don't even know if they're going. If they do go, he can come and fetch me. That's better. That's a little move by.
One of 30 or 40 this morning.
They do go.
The adaptation of the book took, and pre-production, took about a year, year and a half maybe. While Herman was writing the screenplay and sending the material to me, I was traveling around the world, trying to nail down locations.
First thing I did was to read the script and the book, which was an amazing experience to know that, you know, and somewhat daunting to know that we were going to put all this material on film.
It was an extraordinarily difficult project on all levels because you try to lock in locations that you will be using 2 or 3 years down the road, and maybe you'll just be there for 3 days. And, you know, meantime, this is Europe. Wars happen, you know, things collapse. The same with casting actors, as particularly actors in small roles. We would try and, you know, say, well, we've got this fabulous little role for 10 days, but we actually, you'll be shooting in two years and, you know, 3 days. So we had to give all actors, we used to have backups on all the cast, and we had a speaking cast of 300.
Der Führer!
Der Führer!
Also had to have 3 sets of locations for the same location. And the reason I needed that was that if the schedule required that I shoot scene 697 in Italy because of the actors and because of something else that's going on, and scene maybe took place in England, if I had a set for it in Italy, I could shoot it in Italy. I also carried in my back pocket a number of small scenes that just about could be shot anywhere by improvising the set if I had the right actors. And if sometimes I would finish early on a day which was rare, but sometimes it would happen, I would be able to pull one of these scenes out of my pocket if I had the right actors, and if I found something I could improvise, I'd shoot the scene.
I think that our task was to reproduce the spirit of the times and places. There was no way that we were going to be able to reproduce with historical accuracy the places in the story. But there was a way that we could send the message, a kind of aesthetic message to the audience that, you know, what they represented.
The other thing that was very important for me in shooting Winds of War, More Remembrance was to recreate the physicality of that time. And there was an enormous difference physically in what women wore in the late 30s, early 40s. I insisted on wearing girdles, the really old-fashioned girdles that women wore in the 30s and 40s. And stockings with the garter belt rather than, you know, pantyhose, because it changes the way a woman walks and the way a woman sits. It changes her physical freedom.
Oh, dear heaven, I'll die. I get practically nothing on underneath. Why can't they want a girl?
Well, they're wrong.
I love Dan. I really loved working with Dan. He was enormously supportive of me. I always felt that he was very straight. He was a very attentive director. You know, there are so many directors out there today who say, you know, action and cut, and that's the end of the process. That's the beginning and end of the process. So that you never really feel that there's someone there who is really trying to protect you and guard you so that you can climb out to the farthest part of a limb. I had an enormous amount of trust in Dan, and he could be very, very difficult. He really could be, but he never was with me.
Dan is an old school producer and director. He's very much influenced by the kind of moodiness you find in black and white films, and he's also a very disciplined producer and director. This was an enormous project with what were limited resources. We had a lot of ground to cover, and what we tried to do was to find the essential shots that would put you in the place and time of the episode that was beginning. In other words, to establish immediately where you were.
When I got to Yugoslavia, that's where I met Branko Lustig, who ended up basically as my first AD. He was a Yugoslav. He was assigned to us by Yadrin Studios to help us find locations, and I immediately fell in love with the guy. Without him, I never could have completed this film. The most important person on the picture to me is my first AD, particularly when you're working on a very, very difficult film. I just have to worry about how I'm going to shoot this picture, how I'm going to direct it. And if I've got somebody who's in front of me, thinking in front of me, always having the set ready for me, always doing everything as if he were reading my mind, then I can really do what I have to do. Plus, he was a survivor. Concentration camp. He was in Auschwitz when he was 13. And he had a real understanding of the German mentality. So when it came to staging all of those sequences, I mean, he was absolutely invaluable.
I was with him 7 years, actually. We made almost 58 hours together and spent so much time together that we became like almost like brothers. Everybody's saying Dan is very difficult when we were movie making, that he's screaming, that he's a screamer. I don't think so. I think he's a great man, and he had this vision of the book, of the complete book of Hermann Vogt in front of him.
Back there. On the other side, see where the ash can is?
Yes.
If we have
we can one bed there also.
Like two beds, three beds.
In that moment, they're coming.
We see people also crossing over there that way, and they may come around this way. We dolly after them that way.
his directing style was his marvelous imagination, because he knew exactly what he wanted to see on the screen, and how he achieved it, or how you achieved in helping him, depended a lot on you. He wanted a scene played and two people to stand up and tell the truth to one another, or to lie to one another, as they might do. Then he knew exactly photographically in his head what he wanted to see on the screen, and he got it, and if he got it nicely and quietly, that was wonderful, but if he didn't, he got it noisily. He had a kind of a short fuse, but it was wonderful, because if he blew, he blew for a very good purpose, and the whole picture and the actors all came out better for that happening. Pathetic. That's one of his favorite words. Pathetic. I never heard anything like that. For heaven's sake, roll the camera, do it again.
In my collaboration with Dan on The Winds of War, I found him to be very definite about exactly how he wanted the pictures to look. When you work with Dan, he loves to do very low angles, so right away this would dictate a certain lighting style, because when you see all the ceilings and stuff, and gave the pictures a much bolder composition. We had a lot of smoke, a lot of ambient smoke all the time, just to lower the contrast a little bit, and again, complemented with the fog filters, this would create kind of a nostalgic look.
When we started production, obviously I looked at the dailies every day, pretty much. And I was really thrilled. It was hard to believe how good they were. The acting was wonderful, the cast was sensational, the writing was coming through, the production was breathtaking, Dan was getting so much on the screen. There is no director alive now or then who gets more on the screen than Dan Curtis did. It blew my breath away. I would watch it and I'd go, oh my God, where'd those 100 extras come from? I don't believe that. And Dan had this thing endlessly of shooting orchestras. There were always orchestras playing in the background, and we'd be somewhere in Germany and people would be at a tea dance and there'd be an orchestra of 25 people. And there was just this lush, gorgeous, beautiful production. So I never really worried about it very much.
It wasn't like doing a regular film. It wasn't working for 3 months. It was working for a year. And I cannot watch it without thinking about all the things that went on, you know, what went on outside what you see on the camera. It's like seeing a year of your life go by. It brings it all back, all those memories, all those moments, all those days, all those jokes, all those disasters, all the time you froze to death on a mountain in Yugoslavia. I can't watch it without those memories coming back. But they were good memories. I had one of the best times of my life making Winds of War.
In terms of how demented this production was and its demands, is that in one day we actually shot in three different countries. I mean, we woke up in the morning and I think, if I'm not mistaken, we started shooting in Austria. I know we drove across the Alps and we ended up at 4 a.m. in Italy. We shot in three places. In the middle of January, in the middle of a snowstorm, driving through the Alps with all our passports, all our trucks. And then again, when we were casting, we actually cast in three countries one day. And I remember we started the morning in Vienna. We were casting in Vienna in the morning. We took a plane to London. We were casting in London. We took a Concorde to New York. And we ended up the day in New York, seeing like another 7,000 people. And that just gives you some idea of the pace.
I learned one trick early on. Never to take the shooting schedule and look beyond the next day or two. Because I did it once and I thought I was gonna vomit. I just didn't think, there's no way. If you had to think about what you were gonna shoot, you couldn't shoot it. I had no idea how I was gonna do the big battle sequences, the naval battles, the submarine warfare, all of that stuff. So I took that and put it at the very end of the schedule, knowing that I had all of this time to constantly work on figuring out how to do it.
Almost everything we shot, especially battle sequences and everything, were done all live action. The state of optical effects in 1980 was certainly not what it is today. And we didn't have CGI, for example. You weren't able to put in 600 more people. What you see on the screen, if you think you're looking at 600 people, is actually what we had to use.
It's the most complicated things, I suppose, were the battle scenes, the attacks on Cavite Bay and Pearl Harbor, which were staged in Oxnard at Navy Base. They involved period aircraft, lots of explosions, lots of people being flung about. That was a large scale, kind of big film type sequence.
We decided we'd shoot it out at Port Hueneme, and I got all of these destroyers that the Navy was using for target ships. And I figured I'd put them out in the bay, and at a distance, you don't know what the hell they are. And we shot this in one go around. I had eight cameras, and we shot it on December 7th. That is the thing that was so amazing. We could have shot it on the 6th, but I organized a schedule that we would end up shooting it on December 7th. And I'll never forget that day. We were with all these naval officers in one of the offices, and we had big maps laid out of Port Hueneme Harbor and the inlets, and I felt like I was getting ready to fight a war.
Dan wanted to see a flyby rehearsal, and they had been setting charges for weeks, and it was just a massive, huge shot, and there was a still photographer named Roland Bell. And evidently somebody got on the radio and called Roland, and the effects guy thought he said Roland, so no cameras were going and all the charges went off, and this was during the flyby rehearsal.
And I'm watching, and I'm watching, and all of a sudden, the explosions start. I cannot believe my eyes. So I yell, everybody, just keep shooting. Whatever we get, we're gonna get. Planes keep going back and forth, back and forth. We shoot the hell out of this thing until there's nothing left to shoot. We call a cut, and that was Pearl Harbor. And we cut it all together, and the sequence was absolutely fantastic. It was perfect.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
I have to say that we were so lucky to have Bob Cobert, the composer of both Winds of War and War and Remembrance, to work on these projects with his beautiful, sweeping score, which is just so haunting and emotional and appropriate, and which carried both shows, really, all the way through.
I wrote for about a month and a half and came up with what I came down to about 40 different pieces of music that would be appropriate for this show, like about 7 themes for Pug and Pamela, about 10 themes for Rhoda and Kirby, about, you know, blah, 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 like that. And then about 4 or 5 pieces that I thought would do as a main title if they did not pick one of the characters' themes. You go into a screening room with Dan, and you spot the film, which means that you say, right here, we're gonna start with music. And it's gonna go through here, and the mood's gonna change here, and then it'll end here. Then we'll have silence here, and then more music. Well, you go through the entire movie that way. In this case, you know, the 3-hour section, the 3-hour section. And Dan there is pretty much calling the shots. And then he doesn't hear it again until we're on the scoring stage, until I've got 60 people sitting there and I give the downbeat and off we go. And he's back there in the control room with his eagle ear and his eagle eye. And Dan must okay every single note. There is not one note in that score that he doesn't stand behind.
Banner.
Thank you.
there wasn't a dry eye in the house. I mean, just thinking about it, I cried. And then all of them under the big number one gun turrets singing, "Onward, Christian Soldiers." And Churchill and Roosevelt sitting side by side, it was as if you went back in time. The most moving spectacle I've ever seen. I was next to a cameraman, one of the operators that we had up on one of the bridges, and we're bringing a destroyer in, and all the sailors are lined up on the deck. They are all saluting. And he said to me, "I can't see out of the lens." He said, I'm crying so hard, so many tears in my eyes. I can't see out of the lens, out of the eyepiece. I was crying. It wasn't anybody who wasn't crying. I think it's the most moving sequence in the entire picture. Gary Nardino was a very close friend of mine, a one-time agent of mine, was running Paramount Television. And he called me one day and he asked me if I'd be interested in doing The Winds of War. And I had to admit I didn't know what The Winds of War was. And he told me it was a novel by Herman Woke, who I greatly admired. A messenger delivered this 20-pound book. I couldn't believe the size of it. 1,100 pages, whatever it was. And I called Gary and I said, "You out of your mind?" He said, "Just read it and then we'll talk about it."
"I guess this is it then."
"Tumbleweed's blowing apart."
"That's exactly right. Tumbleweed's blowing apart. I pray for Natalie and your son, Byron."
"I know you do, Dad. Thanks."
The Winds of War was the creme de la creme de la creme of a book. Everyone wanted that. It was the one that you thought, if I could get this one particular property, I could make the greatest miniseries of all time. So everyone lusted for it. And Herman Woke basically had no interest in making it a miniseries whatsoever.
Herman Woke never wanted to sell The Winds of War to television, or to anybody for that matter. He was vastly unhappy with the work that had been done in the past, translating his novels to film. He did not like The Caine Mutiny. He hated Marjorie Morningstar. I don't even think he would look at Youngblood Hawk. He was thoroughly disenchanted with Hollywood.
Marjorie Morningstar and Youngblood Hawk were just trivialized. And that wasn't going to happen again with the Winds of War. It just mattered too much to me. So that was out of the question. And once it became a bestseller, number one bestseller, Winds of War, then naturally the offers came. And we just turned them down.
The Winds of War is a really almost perfect book for television. And I'll tell you why, in my opinion. It's about a family, and family stories on television are always the best. And it's a family in crisis as a result of a war. So you have a family that's evolving and changing and growing and relationships shifting throughout the course of their life, set against this backdrop of action and suspense and fear. So it you had the perfect combination of elements to make an extraordinary saga.
Close call there, wasn't it?
What Herman Woke has done that is unique is that he manages to put the average Joe and Jane into the picture as if they were living then and they were breathing the air of 1939 to 1945. And by doing that, he immediately attracts everybody's interest.
I was a naval officer for 4 years in World War II. Served on destroyer minesweepers.
Oh, very much like the USS Kane in the Kane Mutiny. That's my naval background. And out there, it occurred to me that sooner or later, somebody was going to write a big book about this war. And I didn't think it could possibly be me, but it was a dream. And it never quite left me.
Well, Herman Woke's story of the Winds of War is a sweeping study of the history of that period and those events leading up to World War II, and of course the Holocaust. And it has a great importance. It's a period of history that I've lived through, so has Dan Curtis and so has Herman Woke, and we all remember some of the mistakes that all of our governments made and the horror of that war, and how those years of the 1930s, when Winds of War begins, affected the whole world. It's one of those stories that must never be forgotten.
Sieg Heil!
Heil!
Unser Führer Adolf Hitler! Sieg
Heil!
Sieg
Heil!
Sieg
Heil!
When I decided to take a shot at writing this book intended to throw a rope around World War II, I realized that I was in for some very serious reading. And I found myself with a list of 300 books that I ought to read. And I read them, started the research, I would say maybe about 1960. I finished writing War and Remembrance in 1977. So all that is, there 17 years and another about 3 years on the miniseries. So a good part of my life, central part of my life.
This is the famous Pug Henry, dear.
Oh, what a pleasure.
Pug, will the British hold out if France quits?
I don't know much about the British, sir.
Would you like to go there for a spell as a naval observer? Possibly after you've had a month or so back in Berlin?
Mr. President, is there any chance of my not going back to Berlin?
You go back there, Pug.
Aye, sir.
You'll get your sea command in due course.
Yes, sir.
I think the most interesting thing about how the books developed was the German general, Armin von Roon's memoirs, or analysis of the war, which really is the spine, the historical spine that runs through both novels. It was my concept that the story could be told entirely through the experiences of my characters. I was about a year into the writing when I realized that would not work because they did not have the overview. Nobody does in the middle of a war. Nobody has the overview of what's happening. And this character, General Armin von Roon, just walked into the book. And one day I was trying to write some scene or other, and I needed the historical background. And as it were, as though this character walked into my room where I was working, said, I'll take it from here. And he started to describe the war from his viewpoint. That worked, and that was the essential missing piece.
All previous studies inadequate. Assumptions about Soviet Union in view of the proposed Anglo-Soviet alliance are highly hazardous. We are going out on very thin ice.
Von Roon is the only fictional German officer in the story. Mr. Woke wrote him as a military diarist. So he didn't have a family. He was never apprehended in secret meetings or anything like that. So the best I could do was try to infer a certain ambiguity about his loyalty to the Führer. More important than ever to do your background reading and see if you can pick up some tips, maybe even suggest something about the character, which is to augment the character in some way. Research. Nothing to beat it.
Tell me, Victor. What is all that smokescreen about lending and leasing.
Well, there is legal precedent for the leasing of American military property. But the lending of ships and weapons is a novel idea. Of course, they have to be returned in good repair after the war.
It's poppycock.
It's politics.
Check.
I started with Pug Henry because of this, his, the centrality of a figure who would be close enough to the president to see a lot of the aspects of Roosevelt's decision-making without his being in any sense a heroic figure, just a run-of-the-mill, obscure naval officer. In the story, nobody's ever heard of Pug Henry. And nobody ever hears of the Pug Henrys of real life. They are the ones who get things done and never have the 15 minutes of fame. They just, they serve.
Goodbye, Pug.
Goodbye, Mr. President. Goodbye, Mrs. Roosevelt.
I read the book. And of course, I loved it. But I instantly realized that it was half a story, because it ended at Pearl Harbor. And the story was just getting started.
Without counting pages, I just wrote and wrote and wrote, and finally I got to Pearl Harbor. And then I went back and counted the pages, and I saw that I'd written a 1,000-page novel pretty near. And I told this to my wife. I said, what am I going to do now? She said, well, I don't know. Well, the story's just beginning, she said. I talked to my editor then, and we decided there was nothing for it but to tie it off and publish The Winds of War by itself, and indeed, that's what I did. It was Barry Diller who came up with the idea of making a miniseries of the, which was the correct form. I mean, then you have all the room that you need to tell the story. But we thought that was impossible because of the commercials.
Herman finally agreed to let it happen, but with all kinds of provisos. He limited the commercial, the amount of commercial minutes that the network could have. He put restrictions on them that they never dreamed of, and they all bought it.
And the restrictions covered things like what sponsors would be allowed, how many commercials would be allowed, what the commercial positions would be, how many would be connected to each other. And Herman had creative approval on the writer, he had creative producer on director, he had creative approval on the cast. So he was loaded with clauses which were about 47,000 pages long that none of us can understand, which had to do with his control over the production itself. But with that, we got the rights.
Don't marry slowly.
How young you are.
Promise me?
You know what Lennon said, that promises like pie crust are meant to be broken?
Forget about Lennon, just promise me.
You idiot, don't you know how much I love you?
Most of our role was to find the right people and to support them. The hard part of it, of course, was that it was all over the world. I mean, this was going to cost a bloody fortune. This was going to be the biggest thing that television had ever seen in the history of the business. Because the book was so massive, and it involved extras, and it involved attacks, and it involved explosions, and it involved shooting in all these different areas. So the production side of it was really, really difficult. However, actually taking that script, mounting it, putting it on the air, making it happen, making it real, and not just a little cheapo production, but a big mammoth saga, which is what was really needed in terms of the book and in terms of Herman Wolf, that was a tremendous challenge. Tremendous.
I come to the house, and I'm greeted by Herman and Sarah, and right away, I know Sarah takes an instant dislike to me. She thinks I'm Mr. Hollywood. And Herman and I have this long dialogue, and I said to him, you don't understand. I'm my own boss. I have my own company. I mean, this is an interview. I don't need this job. I mean, I have grave doubts about doing it anyway. I got problems with it. And I told him about the fact that I thought it was a half a story. And he allowed us how he would not let anybody get into the second half of the story, which turned out to be War and Remembrance, of course, until he knew they could do the first half. We talked about it again. We got into a huge argument because I said, okay, I will do it, but I won't do it unless I can do the whole thing.
Dan started out by saying, the book is the Bible of the miniseries. We're going to follow the book. And when in doubt, we go to the book. This is what he said to me. In attempting to write for television, I did some ad-libbing, and he said, no, go back to the book. That was the first thing I learned from him, which is, you know, it was music to my ears. The idea, well, all I do is stick to my book, which was, couldn't be better.
The first thing I determined was that we would adapt the book while I was in pre-production. So what I did was sit down and do an outline of the major sequences that I was pretty sure were going to end up in the picture, so that I could then start to look for these main locations. At the same time, we were going to start casting. The writing process and pre-production took probably a year and a half. I was traveling all over the world while Herman was working on the screenplay. I was also drafting some sequences that I would send on to him. And I brought in my good friend Earl Wallace, who was a wonderful writer, who worked as story editor, also worked very closely with us. So we all worked very closely together on the screenplay, with Herman having final word on everything.
Because of our previous experience, we knew practically better than certainly any other network or anybody in the business, what you had to do in order to get everybody into the tent on opening night. We had every single day of the year mapped out on the walls of this conference room. And we met once a week with the public relations people, the photography people, with the on-air people, with the advertising people. And there was a meeting for 1 year prior to the air date of Winds of War, where we would discuss what was going to happen on every single day, 365 days before the premiere night. We ended up, as a result of this kind of attack and this kind of detail on it, we ended up with 17 magazine covers for the Winds of War. We covered absolutely every base everywhere. So we had to take it and turn it into a major monster television event, which we did.
With an actor in the White House, it wasn't surprising to see the superpowers of Hollywood mingling with Washington's power brokers at a special preview screening of the upcoming Winds of War miniseries here at the Kennedy Center.
This is a very extraordinary and unusual film. The character that Robert Mitchum plays, Plug Henry, is kind of an omnipresent character who is on the spot with Mussolini, with Hitler, with Roosevelt. And so all of a sudden you create those years that a good many of us remember with some nostalgia and some sorrow.
I think Winds of War is a piece that is historical, a piece that's important, I think, for a lot of people to see who really have forgotten or were born after World War II and really don't realize what went on at that time. And it's obviously a bipartisan war. Everybody seems to have shown up.
I think that Herman Wilkes and Dan Curtis's movie about World War II is an enormous anti-war document without being didactic.
I think this is enormously instructive. It's interesting. It's fast-moving. And I think all of us can always learn from history.
When I got the part in Winds of War, I had no idea what a big deal this job was. I just really did not. I knew I was doing a big mini-series, but I don't think anyone knew how popular it was going to be, and that on the week or the 10 days when it was airing, you could drive through the town and there wouldn't be a car on the streets. I mean, it was amazing. There were areas of Los Angeles that were like a ghost town because everybody was home watching television.
It's hard to describe the rush that you feel when you get those ratings, but it certainly is extraordinary, and it's also nice to know that you're actually probably going to keep your job until lunch of that day.
I give credit to Brandon Stoddard of ABC for taking this enormous gamble on the notion that the audience, the attention span of the audience could be held 3 hours a night straight through 6 nights of prime time. I don't know if it could be done today. I don't know that the audiences today would stand still for it.
Herman Woke and Dan Curtis were able to tell their story and to have their story impact on the lives of tens of millions of people. And that is surely a lasting contribution to Holocaust education and remembrance.
I definitely think that Winds of War and War Remembrance, its anthology of the wartime, I think one of the best documents ever made about this war.
I didn't know whether I could do it. I didn't know whether people would be interested in the Second World War. I wrote them during the Vietnam War, with marches outside and the kind of turmoil in the country that we now have with Iraq. That was going on then when I was writing the books. And many a day I looked out of my Washington, D.C. window and I could see marches going by. I said to myself, who cares? Who will care about this book? If you've got a theme in which you believe, at least this is the way I've always worked, you do it. And then you see what happens. The fact that the books work the way they did it and the way that the miniseries worked the way they did it just enduring satisfaction to me. But I put in the time and I put in the effort and I stand by the outcome.
I can remember Brandon saying to me, okay, I'll get him in the tent for you, because he promoted the hell out of it. The promotion on the Winds of War was gigantic. After that, it's going to be up to you. I said, okay. I said, what kind of a number do you want? He said, anything with a 5 in front of it. 6 o'clock in the morning, the telephone rings, and it's Brandon. And I said, yeah, he said, 54 share, 80 million people, something insane, right? I got it. He was so happy, and I'm jumping up and down. And then that thing ran that week. It was, it averaged a 54 share throughout the entire week. And I remember being in the supermarket buying something, and people in the line are yelling at people in front of them and to go faster. They have to go home to watch the Winds of War. The restaurants were empty. Mateo's was a restaurant I used to go to. A guy named Matty ran Mateo's. He said to me, you're killing my business. There's nobody in here. It was like this national experience. The world was watching the Winds of War. It was the most unbelievable experience. My wife called up Chasen's because we had a little party, and she wanted to get some chili. And she heard that the chili at Chasen's was great, right? So Maud Chasen gets on the telephone, and she says, this isn't a takeout place. We don't send out chili. And then she says, who'd you say you were? And she said, Mrs. Dan Curtis. And she says, Winds of War, Dan Curtis? And she says, that's right. She said, how much chili do you want? It was an incredible experience. The casting of the Winds of War was a murderously difficult problem. I had absolutely no image of what Rhoda should be. I did have an image of what Natalie should be, and I had an image of what Byron should be, and I did not have an image of what Pug would be. And we went through everybody in this town. It was an absolute killer.
The amazing writer, which is Herman Woke, the fact that he was able to string the history of World War II around a family and their respective spouses and love affairs and carry you from very, very major historical event to event to event by this sort of soap opera string of people whom night after night after night you became more familiar with and more in love with was genius.
Well, that's the challenge of the historical novel, to create characters that live through their experiences, create for the reader a sense of what it was like in those days. The Winds of War and War of Remembrance. It's a panorama of what happened in World War II. And that's the reason I wrote those books, for entertainment.
The story is so gripping that because you're so interested in those average characters that find themselves caught in World War II, through those characters, you sort of come in through the back window to the desk of Churchill and all of the leaders that fought this most important war. And that's why his film, as well as the book, resonated in the minds and hearts of millions of people. And they didn't want to let go of the characters.
Rhoda, this is Natalie Jastrow.
Now, my dear, how very nice you do look.
I had a crush on Ally McGraw. And in the story, in the film, I have a dance sequence with her. I took that excitement of me having a crush and I made that part of my scene, the excitement of that scene. I just let that kind of flow and glow through me. I don't know what Ally was working on, but it was great for me.
I was trying to maintain the relationship of age between Byron and Natalie from the book, where Natalie was older than Byron.
I'd always been in love with Ally McGraw. She was like one of those sort of iconic figures like Audrey Hepburn for me. She carried with her some incredible private dignity and sort of a non-Hollywood quality, an independent quality, a very intelligent quality with a lot of class.
I said, but she's too old. And Barbara said, she looks unbelievable. Just meet her. I said, fine, bring her in. So in came Ally, and she looked fantastic. I said to her, I don't want you to get nervous. I'm going to sit you right in front of a window. And daylight, harsh, revealing daylight is going to come pouring in on your face because I'm going to do lots of big close-ups of you. And you've got to look right.
Look, I'm needed here. You go if you want to. I'm staying.
If the neutrals leave, we have to be with them.
Naturally. I hear what you're saying. The young man is right. You have to go with your people.
But we don't even know if they're going. If they do go, he can come and fetch me.
You can't take that risk.
You are true.
That language much better.
Much better.
Natalie Jastrow is a dream part, really. The whole Winds of War thing for me was a dream work experience. And of course, we all know that she was a Jewish American girl caught in Europe at the beginning of the war. Not quite certain what was going on, as was half the rest of the world, but definitely not able to escape. First of all, she's a tremendously American girl in Europe the whole time. There is that essential Americanness that, never mind, I can do it myself, I'm independent, everything's going to be fine, I'll take care of this, which I think for a woman is a very American quality. Headstrong, opinionated, these are things I can relate to very well. And a survivor, and I loved the part. I just loved her. I thought she and I have a certain resilience in common that worked for me.
Byron!
I remember Jan Michael Vincent's screen test because for some reason they had cast Natalie, but they hadn't cast Byron, and there were several very talented actors that had to be paired off with me for a screen test. And Jan was one of them. And he arrived at the studio and he said, I never got the pages. And somebody said, you didn't? And he said, no, I didn't. And he picked them up and he looked at them and they yelled, roll them, action. And Jan was like, perfect. And this is an actor whom the camera loved. And he had learned his lines just sort of glancing at them in 5 minutes, and he was electrifying. Jan and his entourage had a major off-screen party life, and it didn't matter. He turned up for work. He was terrific to work with for me. We had great chemistry, and it was magic.
He had the Byron quality, and one of the qualities that Byron had was this footloose young guy wandering around Europe right before the war exploded. Somebody who was self-sufficient, somebody who had a rebel streak to him. And I had heard stories that Jan was a problem. And he and I sat down before we started, And I said to him, I'll explain something to you, Jan. You and I are going to have it straight down the middle here. You step out of line on me once and I'm going to kick your ass. Which I probably never could have done. And he said, that's what I like. I like to hear that.
Go.
Okay, that's what's wrong.
Larry, you don't have to say your line.
Yeah, Natalie, for God's sake.
One of the biggest problems I had was he never came prepared. But by the time we would get through the first rehearsal, it would get me madder than hell. But by the time we would get through that first rehearsal, he'd had a down pat. Guy was an absolute natural.
I looked at what it was like to be in love.
Me? Of course not. What a silly thing to say. I'm a million years old.
The casting of Rhoda, another huge problem. I did not have my mental image of Rhoda, but the one thing I knew about Rhoda was that she shouldn't be strong. She should have some kind of a flighty quality to her. And a meeting was set up for me to meet Polly. I met her and I loved her instantly, but I knew she was totally wrong for Rhoda.
The truth is, really, no one wanted me. It was that simple. First of all, and I understand, I had not worked as an actress, basically, in a little over 10 years. I'm a ferocious reader, so I had read both Winds of War and War and Remembrance and decided that Rhoda was the part that I had to play.
Dinner at the White House? But what is it, Puck? Is it a state banquet or something, or one of those huge affairs?
No, just a quiet dinner. Our family, the President and Mrs. Roosevelt.
Puck. Oh, Puck, just us and the Roosevelts? What have you been up to?
Nothing. A little errand running. This is just a carrot for the donkey.
A carrot for the donkey? It's magnificent.
I had a lot of arguments about the character of Rhoda. Both Dan and Mitch felt that she was, they called her round-heeled. They felt that she played around. I never thought of Rhoda that way. I never saw her that way. I've always felt that Rhoda was a victim. I felt she was a victim of her time. She was a military wife. And the life of a military wife in the 20s and 30s, and probably even today as well, is to really be the helpmate to your husband, to be prepared to pick up and leave and go somewhere totally foreign and different and strange and new whenever they decide to send him somewhere else. Your success and recognition as a woman is based on the success and recognition of your husband.
How about this? Is this the reward for the conquering hero?
Exactly.
We had a very tough time casting Pamela Tudsbury. I think we saw every actress in England. I mean, we were at the end of our rope when Victoria Tennant walked in. I knew the moment that she walked through the door that Dan was going to use her.
I was really getting desperate. The door opened up. And in walked this vision, Victoria Tennant, this beautiful blonde, great legs, great body, and absolutely incredible looking. And I said a silent prayer, dear God, please let her be elect.
I've asked for a special pass. I think I'll come up to London tonight. Would you buy me dinner?
I loved my part with all my heart. I've completely believed in my character. In Pam Tudsbury. I believed in her relationship with Robert Mitchum's character. I thought it was romantic and historic, and it was such a big endeavor. The scenes were so huge that it wasn't hard to convince myself that I was in the real situation.
I love you. No, don't say anything. I just wanted you to hear me say it.
You've never heard me say it before, but it's been true for such a long time.
I think Mitchum was the toughest one. I didn't know what Pug Henry should be. In terms of a physical look, I didn't know what Pug should be. But it was a very, very tough part to cast because you really needed a star, someone who was in their early 50s probably, maybe late 40s, and there wasn't anybody.
It was very difficult to think of a man that, who would not be ludicrous historically, that you can see in a personal relationship with his wife and his family, and at the same time in a relationship with Churchill, with Hitler, with Roosevelt, all these historical figures where he has to have power and authority. I don't think anybody could carry that other than Mitchum, because he has this stubborn intelligence. One of the best things about having Mitchum in that role is that he really represented that era.
I was taken in to see Mr. Mitchum, who I was terrified of, who I'd never met before. And we were supposed to start filming for 14 months, and I hadn't met him before. No one had introduced us. And there was this icon, this incredible, huge, famous, amazing-faced man. And I thought, oh, please let him like me. Please let it be all right. He was very generous and very real. He taught me not to be nervous. There wasn't a nervous bone in his body. And he always said, the day they catch me acting, I'll quit. It was the best job I ever had. It was 14 months of employment with people who were very good to me.
Victor.
I don't remember ever doing anything that I so looked forward to going to work to do. And people have asked me many, many times, what is the work that I am proudest of? And they expect me to say the Helen Morgan story, which I won an Emmy for, or they expect me to say Cape Fear, or, you know, one of those things. And the work that I am proudest of is Winds of War and War and Remembrance. I think that it's the best work I ever did.
It was a great joy. It was lots of trouble, lots of grief. And it was the experience of my life. One of the big reasons we chose to go to Yugoslavia and do a lot of our work there was they had made a number of pictures over there, had a good number of people that could crew for us, and were willing to make great money deals with us. It was very inexpensive to shoot in Yugoslavia. And it also offered us many opportunities to shoot. We could shoot Italy and Yugoslavia, we could shoot Berlin, we could shoot Moscow, any number of places that we were able to shoot in Yugoslavia. We got cheap help. They had a great lab in Zagreb. Food was terrific. And it was a wonderful country. So we shot as much as we could possibly shoot there. We shot there in winter, we shot there in summer.
Roll it!
Bid. 313 Z, take two.
Quinte Monti.
Our base of operations was Zagreb, which, as a former capital of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, even though it is remote in today's Europe, or was then, it had all the grand interiors and exteriors that we needed and could stand in for a lot of the capitals of the period. Zagreb at that time was relatively untouched. The reign of Marshal Tito was just ending. It was a communist country. It had not been transformed by commercialism, so there was very little tourist activity. Things were pretty much as they had been. Also, it was relatively untouched by the war. So a lot of things remained, a lot of the atmosphere remained that didn't exist in the rest of the advanced western side of Europe.
Let's do it.
go with it.
Aksya!
I was the unit publicist on The Winds of War for all of the European shoot, which was most of the year. The publicist is there to write about the actors, to work with the photographer, and to bring guests in, visiting press, to do their interviews with the actors. Although, in the case of Mitchum, made it easy because Mitchum had it in his contract that he would do no interviews while he was shooting. Mitchum really hated being interviewed.
You have a complaint?
We are a party of Americans, military attachés. We didn't rise for your anthem. We are neutrals. This waiter chose to take offense. He has been deliberately clumsy, rude, and dirty. He jostled the ladies. His conduct has been swinish. You tell him to behave himself, and we need a clean cloth for our dessert.
Was fällt Ihnen ein? Robian, Sie werden sich sofort zusammenreißen und diese Gäste freundlich und zuvorkommend bedienen, wie das hier im Kaiserpavillon üblich ist.
You will be served properly. My apologies.
Well done. Beautifully done.
Oh, Pug does have a way about it.
Hey, Dad. We hadn't had our dessert.
Nobody had ever written a book at that time about the making of a miniseries like this. And the people who were the head of my department said, do that. Go and stay with them. And just write about what you see. They just said, do it. And I wound up writing it as a journal, simply because that seemed to work.
Okay, Chin Chin.
Chin Chin.
Now, this is not going to be slowed down immediately. You'll see why. Mm-hmm. That's great.
Take nine.
Stuff. It's very good.
I learned more about what movie-making life is like on Winds of War than I had in the 20 years of working on film sets before that. That happens when you're on location, it becomes a different world.
Action!
All four special action groups will jump off today. We will begin actions immediately in the border docks. Himmler will be sending in daily figures.
Okay, cut.
Purified bone.
All right. You can't, if you're going to say your line, now you're playing it much faster, which is good.
I like that.
You're doing it right, but you're going to have to start much later.
Right.
Okay, you're playing it fine. I want you to play it that way. Don't, before it was too slow. All right, now hold on for a second. You can't kneel down until you kneel down and you rub the dog's head and then you say, so begins the fulfillment of a dream.
All right. Let's go again.
When you find yourself working this hard in these killer hours, which they are, you become a family. It's a cliche you've heard a lot, but it becomes a family and an adventure. It's the best part of making a movie, as far as I'm concerned, is what goes on with the 15 or 20 people that are really making it happen. And so here we all are, and we all have one language, which is make this movie. And everybody on this crew is the best. So it's wonderful. I just love it.
Whenever she had a day off, we would take Allie into town, in the middle of town, just with the photographer, just to shoot. And Allie even had managed to learn enough simple courtesies in Croatian so that she could sort of talk to people at the in the open markets, or at least attempt to.
Yeah, it's gonna come up.
Yeah, like this.
Magic.
Okay, let's get him up. Ah. No, moment.
And the people of Zagreb were so delighted that this incredibly beautiful American star was at least trying
to learn a little of their language, that they would swarm around her. She was great with kids. There was one moment there with pigeons and breadcrumbs and a little girl who just attached herself to Allie and wouldn't go away.
All the actors really enjoyed themselves in Yugoslavia. We used to eat in a restaurant up on top of the hotel up on the 17th floor. A big gang of us would sit around a table up there. I remember the night that I met Topol there. Topol was playing Beryl Jastrow. It was a great experience. We were all sitting at a table, and I never met him before. He was cast on the telephone, and I cast him after seeing him on Fiddler on the Roof. Somebody taps me on the shoulder. I turn around, and I look, and there's this young guy smiling at me. I have no idea who it is. And he says, don't get scared. He says, I am Topol. And I look at him, I can't believe it. He says, I know, I look very young, but don't worry, tomorrow I'll look very old. So, he was a young guy, young, vibrant guy, and he made up great, so he was beautiful. Everybody loved it in Yugoslavia. They toured all over the country. Allie used to love the flower markets and the food markets, and it was just, they had a great time.
You all right?
Who are you, anyway?
Okay, I just forgot.
Are you really Mr. Right? Okay. Or might you be Mr. Wrong?
I'm ready anytime you are.
Could be.
I am right.
I am always right.
Excuse me in the background, please.
You are not wrong.
Okay, as soon as it's serious, I can do it.
All right, it's really tragic now. Okay, pay attention.
Everybody's great. Every little part on all the way through has been unbelievable. How they've blended and fit.
I love it. It's a great, great, fun group, and it's so interesting the way everybody approaches it. And then, of course, as we've worked, you know, I mean, I started in January, and we're in May now. We all sort of know each other and speak languages, and it's been a great, great time.
Being on location, I think most filmmakers would agree that while there are physical discomforts and loneliness and a sort of aura of unreality that you have to deal with when you go back to your real life, there is a much closer feeling amongst the people working on the film, and there is a much greater concentration if you are on location because you don't have the distractions of your everyday life. You do tend to think about what you're doing 24 hours a day. Everyone becomes mono-minded, and the project benefits.
If I'm asked, what do you remember about Winds of War? I remember my life. I don't mean my life in America. I remember days, breakfasts, odd tableaus that I saw for the first time when I arrived on the set. Pictures like that plane crashed in the square in Yugoslavia, just smoldering. The miracle of Dan Curtis's art department, which I think was the most astonishing work I've ever seen. We did maybe 50 setups a day sometimes.
Just get a lot of it up in the air. Let's go. Can we shoot it? Somebody's talked to me.
We are ready.
Clearly, we are not behind the German lines.
Look, we are perfectly go.
Cut. Do a pickup. One more time. Let's try it again. Roll it.
He's like a ringmaster of a circus, and the more chaos, and the more difficult, and the more demanding, and he's a frustrated general, actually, Dan. He really, you know, he really should have been Patton, because he needs these troops around him, and he feeds off this energy, and his intelligence feeds off this energy. It's a perfect material for him, because it's so operatic, it's so powerful, it's so profound, it's World War II, it's what turned the world around on its axis. I mean, it doesn't get better than that.
I read the call sheet. I think it's hilarious. I've got to read you what's on call besides us. Where is it? It's here somewhere. It makes me laugh. This is just one day wherein 50 Polish guns for soldiers, 4 cows, 4 pigs, 8 horses for cannons, 1 cannon in the car vicinity, 1 dog, Swedish ambassador, 4 army trucks, 6 horse-drawn cannons. I mean, I've never been in a movie like this, where the call sheet had a page and a half of what's going to go on in back of you. And It's fun. I mean, logistically, it's a nightmare for them.
We shot in rain and snow and sleet and hail, and we went through all the seasons, and we just worked. We didn't care what it was. I can remember one time we were rigging the lights on a car for doing a running shot, and it started raining, and I'm out there working, and pretty soon I notice all the extras are kind of walking away, and I look around, and I'm standing out there by myself. Everybody found out that the Yugoslav extras, the farmers, wouldn't allow their animals to work in the weather. They didn't care if we did, but they wouldn't let the animals work, and so they took all the animals home and left. So we wrapped for the day.
The thing I liked most about Yugoslavia was the innocence. The people were wonderful in Yugoslavia. It was still a communist country, and it was very impoverished, but it had this tremendous innocence. And wherever you went, you know, people were very happy to see you. It had a tremendous amount of charm. Quaint villages, that wonderful little village that we shot in, and where we did the Jewish wedding, where Beryl Jastrow's son was getting married. Oh, what a beautiful little place. And we actually used the rabbi, and the real rabbi, and a real cantor.
It was amazing to go out into the country in Yugoslavia at that time. I mean, you were literally going back in time. The people were very simple. They lived the same way that the previous 10 generations had lived. I'm afraid that a lot of that is gone now, and it's a great tragedy.
I loved every single solitary minute of making Winds of War. I can't say that about everything I've ever done. I felt I was part of something really important, really honorable, really larger than life, that would touch millions of people, and that had a authenticity and a quality to it that very few actors ever get to sign on for the 12 months of work that it represented for me. So I have no bad memories. I have only huge pride that I was asked to be part of it.
I went to with my mother to Auschwitz, and I spent there 2 years, 2.5 years, and then I came back. Before I went to Bergen-Belsen, where I met my mother again after 2.5 years, and then we came back to Yugoslavia, and my father was killed during this time in Yugoslavia. And then in 55, I started making movies. And from then until today, I'm always dedicated to movies that are talking about Holocaust.
Gentlemen, we are finished here. Move everything out from here. We will put the car now on the trailer, and we'll meet first from there to that side with trailer. Thank you.
Franco, let's get a rehearsal with the car while we're waiting for that.
Franco, where do we prepare it?
Down there, yes, on the crossing.
Idemo desto sada, svi tamo, ponesemo sve stvari, osim statista, krava, topova.
I think that the importance for me of Winds of War actually is very much to do what I mentioned that an old Yugoslavian said to me about why they make war movies, so that our children will know that the life we have wasn't just gifted to us.
I mean, he's just got goosebumps going through some of this stuff, walking on these locations, and I never get tired of it. It was the toughest thing I ever had to do, yet I never get tired. I could have kept shooting forever.